Today, 10 years on, Jerusalem is calm, apparently at peace. Its Jews secure in the belief that it is now theirs forever.
We are here now in no man's land. There was no traffic on this road. There was a wall there dividing the two parts of the city.
After 10 years as mayor of all Jerusalem, Teddy Kollek exudes that confidence about the city which Israel would wish the rest of the world to share.
Jews are absolutely certain that this is their capital. It was their capital since David made it its capital 3,000 years ago. And even when they were away for 2,000 years, they prayed for this as their capital every day. And once or so and during the year, they said next year in Jerusalem, and that meant returning to the old glory and to the old independence. So now it had happened. And now it's ours, and we shan't let it go again.
Do you rejoice 10 years on in its unity, or do you have doubts about it?
I have no doubts about the unity. I think we have problems, but so has Montreal between French and English, so has Washington between white and black, so has certainly Belfast or Beirut, so has even Brussels or South African cities. I think it goes a lot better here. We have a lot of hope.
You don't like eggs.
You don't like eggs.
We don't need sweaters.
The Jews in Jerusalem exhibit no self-doubt. Muriel Jollis, a new immigrant from Lancashire, teaches English to Jewish children in a school which stands on Arab land in East Jerusalem, and it gives her no qualms. The parents and grandparents of these pupils have come to settle in Israel from every continent, to a refuge from persecution, pogrom, and Holocaust.
We live in Jerusalem, we don't live in Tel Aviv.
Very good.
But this school is an assertion of Jewish right secured by Israeli might. 10 years ago, these children were toddlers, and today they are still innocent of the issues which put them at the dangerous center of the world's most profound conflict. To them and their teacher, it's enough that Jerusalem seems to be one city.
It could be the prophecy coming true, where something comes out of Jerusalem for the good of the world. And I think that a united Jerusalem is something that has to be. Otherwise, it's going to. Jerusalem should be all the cultures together, united. And it's got to be united. I mean, 2,000 years, they've always said in the Passover ceremony, Shana Haba, the Yerushalayim. This is something that next year in Jerusalem. And so it's something very important and vital for the Jewish people. Otherwise, I think the Jews will cease to exist as such.
The fruit of victory 10 years ago was the Western Wall, where the Jewish faith enjoins its followers to bewail the destruction of Solomon's Temple, their holy of holies for more than 2,000 years. For 20 years, until 1967, the division of Jerusalem denied access to the wall. In victory, the Jews vowed never to yield the city. The Jewish faith and the Jewish state had at last met together in Zion, and the myth that the Jews had a supreme and inalienable right to the city was realized at last, whatever international opinion or law might say about it. That their nation is built upon the ruins of another is a thought that most Jews do not easily contemplate.
The thing that happened in 1967 was definitely an irreversible historic act. It's something that cannot be altered just by force of arms. Of course, like many other things, there's a price for everything. So for this thing, we pay a very heavy price.
In 1967, Meron Benvenisti became responsible for the affairs of Arab East Jerusalem. He's uncomfortably aware that order is not peace, that calm is illusion.
The city is torn. You have two ethnic groups living in the same city. A quarter of a million Jews and 100,000 Arabs. And they are part of the conflict. And this is perhaps the heart of the matter. And they don't see eye to eye the future of the city. The Arabs feel themselves being occupied by the Jews. The Jews feel entitled to have the whole of the city under their own jurisdiction. Therefore, this is a tragic conflict.
If you were an Arab, would you feel yourself to be occupied by Jews?
Definitely, definitely.
It's not common for Israelis to feel that, is it?
Well, you have to ask the Arabs what they feel, and if they feel that they're occupied, they're occupied. This is a subjective matter. You can't tell them, look, you are liberated. Liberation and occupation are things that you have to ask the people what they feel about them. And you have, being an Israeli, and I am an Israeli, stand up with this feeling that 100,000 of my neighbors, my immediate neighbors, feel occupied and feel that I occupy them.
And to occupation, there is a painful and dangerous logic. Its point of departure, that victory for the Jews was defeat for the Arabs, but not final, for the Arabs won't and can't surrender. The old city enshrines the conflict. Misunderstandings between Arab and Jew proliferate, distrust festers. Small incidents combine with great blunders to drive a lasting wedge between each side. The issue is basic, land and homes.
And this before was... Who was living in this house, for instance?
Arab here.
It was an Arab house. How many families were living in there?
Maybe 20 families.
Most of the Jewish quarter of the old city was owned by Arabs, but until their expulsion in 1948 was inhabited by Jews. In victory after 1967, Israel began to evict the Arabs. Now the quarter will house Jews again, and only Jews. The process of eviction in East Jerusalem has been aggressive. An assertion by Jews of their right to a national heritage here.
Do you think the tourists know how you feel?
When tourists admire a Roman wall, which was uncovered through the destruction of his house by Jews, an Arab feels lasting pain. The wound of occupation is deepened. And so the logic presses on. If the parents won't, perhaps the children will acknowledge Israel. But the conflict over Jerusalem is not just between Jew and Arab. It is most profoundly between Israel and Palestine. And so in the flush of conquest, the Jews sought to blur the national identity of the young Arabs, imposing on all Arab schools an Israeli education. In part, they sought to eliminate anti-Semitic teaching. But more than that, they obliterated Palestine from the curriculum, placing Israel in its stead. It didn't work. And children over 12 are now taught according to the Jordanian syllabus. But still, Israel seeks to contain the Palestinian spirit. It can't be done.
You see, every article which mentioned about the Palestine and the people of Palestine, they threw out of the books.
Why is that?
You didn't find in the books something called Palestine or Palestine people.
Why is that, do you think?
I think that they are quarreling or fighting to forget us, our political identity.
Does it work?
I don't think it is work, because we are more and more anxious and called for our political identity.
So Arab children are reared to become people of Palestine, not Israel, inhabiting their own city as strangers under occupation by an enemy power. But the logic is insistent. Israel's security requires Palestinian submission. So if you're an Arab in East Jerusalem, you may not form a political party, hold a rally, join a demonstration, strike, or even close your shop in protest. To assert in public and together, we are Palestinian and you have stolen our land, is to agitate. And agitators can be deported suddenly, and hundreds have been, or detained without charge or trial for days, weeks, months, even years. So Arabs must choose, submit or resist. To submit is to deny your essence, to resist is to court retribution. Arabs in East Jerusalem will not usually talk freely in the open. This garage owner, for instance, will not acknowledge Israel, but dare not defy. To press for the truth causes profound discomfort.
Do you accept that you are now standing in Israel?
I don't think so. What do you mean by that, Jimmy?
Do you believe this to be Israel, where you're now standing?
I don't think that will be the permanent situation. It will be too difficult for both sides.
If it were to remain Israel, what would you do?
I can't imagine what I'll do. I can't tell you now.
Do you feel free to say exactly what you think?
I feel free to tell you whatever I want, but not now. I don't want to tell.
This 16-year-old boy fears recognition. Arrested more than once for incitement, but never convicted, he claims that to extract confessions, he and many others have been beaten up in jail.
Where did they hit you?
On our back and the head. You know, I can see in the whole body. You know, and they was by their hands and our face. So if someone of us fall off in blood, he said to the police, "The blood fell from me." They say, "Shut your mouth," and they give him another one in the same place.
If the Israeli police arrest you, and if you are punished again, if you are caught, will that stop you in future? Will you say, "Okay,
so
I don't do it again"?
Listen, you know, when they arrest me or something like that, I could say in front of them, "I never do something like that." I'm sure when I got outside and I see something like this in prison, I'm going to do more things.
That boy hid his face from the camera because he was frightened of being arrested again and brought here to the Moscow compound, the detention and interrogation center of the Jerusalem police. Here, it is alleged, over the last 10 years, individuals under interrogation have been subjected to harassment, ill treatment, and torture on a scale which, if the allegations are true, constitutes a persistent and gross violation of human rights. Jamil Abu Ghabieh is one of few prepared to testify in public. Arrested in February 1976 for incitement, he alleges that he was beaten up on the way to prison and that then in the Moscow compound he was tortured. A man brought a stick and started to hit me on the soles of my feet until the stick broke. He got another stick and broke it in the same way. He started to tell jokes, and when I wouldn't laugh, he began to hit me, to punch me. This beating up went on until dawn. By the second day, I was in a terrible state, my face badly swollen. In the evening, they took me to a hospital where they took x-rays and found that my head wasn't fractured. After 9 days, Jamil was freed without charge. A doctor saw him the next day. His certificate supports the allegations. Mohamed Atwan was arrested in May 1974, held for a month without charge, and released with the instruction to return to the Moscow compound on the 2nd of June 1974. He obeyed. His record of that day is as follows. Four interrogators entered the room. They shouted at me and made fun of me. One of them pulled my hand back and twisted it. Then they began to hit me. Another put his arm around my neck and started hitting me with his other hand. Then they said, "You must help us." I said, "I won't. You can imprison me or execute me, whatever you like." One of them banged his hand on the table, said, "You must serve the state of Israel." He kept pushing me and hitting me in the face. Still, I refused to cooperate. Then they started to hit me on my genitals. Then one of them brought an electric wire and connected one end to the wall and put the other end on my head. They asked me a question which I couldn't answer. When I didn't answer, he started to hit me. Within seconds, I fell down, and I don't know whether they used electric shocks or not. Mohamed Atwan has not been charged, tried, or sentenced for any offense. Again, the medical evidence supports his allegation. Now he's free, but a sick man. The allegation that torture is persistent and widespread has been made most prominently by a Jewish lawyer, Felicia Langer. A member of the Communist Party, which is committed to the survival of Israel, she is reviled by many fellow Jews as a traitor. What matters is whether she tells the truth.
I want to open the eyes of honest people and of my people. I want to show the other face of my people, because I want to live here and to stay here. I have no other homeland. My eyes are not deceiving me for so many years. It is impossible. Why they are not contesting case by case what I am saying in my books and in my article? Why they are making a silence conspiracy against what I'm writing, what I'm saying in Israel here? Why, if the conscience is so clear and pure, they have to say explicitly, "You are lying in Mr. Abu Ghabieh case. You are lying in Omar Salana case." Not. They don't dare to say that I lie here, because they know that I'm telling the truth. They said truth, but the truth.
We as Jewish people, we suffered so much in our history by attempt to liquidate our identity that I do not believe that any reasonable Jewish person will ever try to suppress the identity of
any other nation or any other religion. Why? What for?
In East Jerusalem, the Arabs do not have the political rights which the Jews in the west of Israel do have.
They certainly enjoy freedom of speech and freedom of expression and freedom of movement, and they can obviously worship their Lord to be completely free religiously and completely sincere in their feelings. We don't ask anybody to change his mind or connections.
In East Jerusalem, the Arabs do not have all those rights.
For example, what don't they have?
The Arabs of East Jerusalem do not have the right to form their own political parties. They don't have the right to express their Palestinian identity.
They can have.
They don't have the right to demonstrate.
Well,
they don't have the right to call rallies. All of the things which the Jewish population of Israel is permitted to do.
They can have all those rights in 5 minutes' time, no problem. They were offered Israeli citizenship the minute they will become, as they have the right to, citizens of this country. They will certainly have all the rights that goes with citizenship. But since they have refused and they are holding their Jordanian passports, I mean, there is a limitation to it, especially, let's face it, in a highly tense situation.
You cannot have a situation in which in one city you have people who have deprived of their rights and other people who have the full right.
Israel Shahak is a Jew, a professor at the Hebrew University. His father died in the Nazi Holocaust. As a child, he endured 2 years in Belsen. His words are a plea to his own people.
This situation is not only harmful, it is suicidal for the oppressors and the oppressed together, and more to the oppressor. It will destroy us. It is not only, of course, first of all, I care to help the people who suffer. But immediately after this, I say that the government who makes such a position, which is both unjust and also unrealistic, is leading my people to destruction. It is not the first government who does so to its own people.
And you wish Israel to survive?
And I wish the Jewish people in this area of the world to survive. It is first of all the people and then the state. Of course, if the state of Israel will be a just state, it will survive. If it will be not just a just state, it will happen to it exactly what the prophet said about the ancient Jerusalem. It will not survive.
The warning echoes unheard. Instead, on the hills around Jerusalem, on Arab land, the Jews have served notice on the world that the city is theirs forever. The barricade of settlements around East Jerusalem are an assertion, in defiance of world opinion and regardless of international law, that the Jewish state will not readily yield the holy city. French Hill, Neve Yaakov, Gilo and Ramot provide homes for Jews and fortresses for Israel, a diplomatic fait accompli in occupied territory, an aesthetic upheaval which cements the physical and numerical ascendancy of Jew over Arab at the heart of the conflict over the Middle East. It troubles few souls in Israel.
If you talk in terms of war and peace, I don't think that war and peace is going to start because there's a housing project on a hill somewhere in Jerusalem. If you think in terms of war and peace, there is nothing we should do here. Because if this is a very, I would say, a very pessimistic view. If you accept that the Arabs would not recognize, the Jews would not recognize, there is no solution to the question. The only solution is to resort to arms. There is no solution today that will enable the city to continue, except for that the present rulers of Jerusalem will be in control of the city. The only possible way is that we'll build cooperation between the two ethnic groups based on an understanding, and this is hard on us and hard on the Arabs, that we are permanent here, therefore we have to leave all options open for peace whenever it'll come, and in the meantime, we have to survive.
Are you, in principle, prepared under any circumstances to surrender sole sovereignty over Jerusalem?
No, sir. I think Jerusalem was artificially divided by war. All the agreements we had about Jerusalem were never guarded, not even by the Jordanians. the city was under constant danger and attack. This is the heart of the Jewish people, geographically, morally, and historically. And I do not believe that we are going to cut our hearts again. And what for?
To suppose that this holy city is at peace with itself is an illusion. Jerusalem is both the symbol and the core of the Middle East conflict, the most intractable issue between Muslim and Jew, Arab and Israeli. And so, if the Geneva talks are to take place, it's almost inconceivable to suppose that the subject of Jerusalem can indefinitely be left off the agenda. But so profound are the conflicts that simply to raise the matter is to make the prospect of peace more remote than ever. And in the Middle East, no peace soon means war.